We will have a brief, short discussion on the book, as I see most of our audience has left for the evening, as expected, I suppose, unfortunately. We have Dr. N. Bhaskar Rao, Dr. Reena Ramachandran, and Shri Madhubhushi Sridhar Acharyulu to discuss about The Restless Futurist, the biography of Dr. Seth, which was released by Hon’ble Shri Pranab Mukherjee. And once they've made their points and said what they wanted to say about the book, then I would like Mr. Kapoor to come and conclude the discussion with them.
The advantage of being a woman is that you're in minority, you're meant to sit center stage.
Okay, a brief introduction to our panel. Dr. N. Bhaskar Rao is a pioneer of social research in India and an eminent mass communication expert with over 40 years of experience with studies on public opinion, customer satisfaction, broadcasting, advertising trends and mass communication opportunities, rural marketing and cephalology-based election surveys are benchmarks in their respective fields today. Dr. N. Bhaskar Rao is the founder chairman of CMS, the Center for Media Studies, and the prestigious Market Research and Forecasting Unit, MDRA, Marketing and Development Research Associates. Dr. Reena Ramachandran is a former CMD of Hindustan Organic Chemicals, currently independent director at the board of United Phosphorus Limited and Indian Additives Limited. Served as member of the Task Force, Performance Management Division, Cabinet Secretariat, member, Board of Governors, IIT Kanpur, Senior Scientific Officer, Ministry of Science and Technology, member, Governing Board, Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, and expert member, Technical Advisory Committee on HR for the Reserve Bank of India. She was awarded the Lifetime Achievement Award by the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas for outstanding contribution to oil and gas industry during Urja Sangam 2015. And last but not the least, Madhubhushi Sridhar Acharyulu, who recently retired as Central Information Commissioner, is one of India's most resolute advocates for transparency and for strengthening citizens' right to information. He was a professor of law at the National Academy of Legal and Research, Legal Studies and Research, University of Law, Hyderabad, before being appointed as a Central Information Commissioner in November 2013. He passed several crucial RTI orders in high-profile cases during his five-year term. A big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, for the esteemed panel. And now I give it to you, sir, and of course, our author, Dr. Rakesh Kapoor, to commence the proceedings for this discussion. Thank you so much.
No, no, I think the panelists, you can begin, sir.
Yeah.
I think who?
You.
The panelists have to start, then only I respond.
Good evening. The future is here today. For sure, touching each of us, all of us, discussing about or remembering, recalling Dr. S.E. Seth, that's what it is. And I'm very fortunate to have been inspired by him over a period of 22 decades. And in fact, three books that I wrote, 1975, the India 2010, in 75, and another one, India 2021, in 87. They were all because of my association with him in those early years. And there are two other books that recently I have written, and one which is going to come very soon, about the decline of social research in India, wherein I refer to him a bit. But Thanks to Padma ji and Aditya ji and Rakesh ji. For sure, the book will go a long way. It has everything to revive a discipline. Not just Dr. Seth, but a discipline. It revives a discipline in India. It inspires, it convinces, and reminds, of course, the work of four decades of Dr. S. C. Seth. And as has been said by Aditya in his introductory remarks, I think that's what I said, revives. Because there were years where and when we were talking about the futurology very seriously. But unfortunately, something happened in between. That's what I want to thank Rakesh Kapoor. It is a landmark contribution, I would call it, the book. I'm sure you are, some of you or many, all of you should read or refer it to others. If you are associated with any academic community, more so, you should tell them that the book need to be discussed and debated too. The relevance of Dr. Seth's work and his contribution is presented very convincingly, and relevance of it today, I want to come to that point. As a person engaged in public opinion research for 50 years and in futurology too, I would like to express, since the time is very short, I don't want to go into details. Today, we hardly think beyond this year, this election. And at least when the Planning Commission started my book on 1987, India 2021, my preface was this, that a five-year concept is outlived. Nehru, when Nehru and Mahanlobi thought about it and brought it from Soviet Union, then Soviet Union, the 5 year perhaps was okay, but then it is too short a period to address the issues, deep-rooted issues of this country. That was what I wrote. Today, but looking at from 1987 and today, 2019, we hardly think beyond today and this election or this year at the moment or this budget at the most. 70 years ago, it was visionaries who shaped, set the destinies and set up many institutes. In fact, this week, I don't know how any of you have seen the BBC serials about what this country contributes to the global scenario. How that period of futurologists, I would call them visionaries, means futurologists, which includes Dr. Seth, I would include him in that. Today, we lost the difference between cephalology and futurology. It's unfortunate. It's an irony. We lost the difference between the cephalology. What is cephalology? Forecasting the elections or outcomes of an election and futurology. This book, that's why I was very impressed about this book, because first time it brings out in a very simplistic way and using Dr. Seth's ideas across. So that's why I say it revives a discipline. Today, we lost the difference between cephalology and futurology. Since I dabbled in both the fields, both in cephalology as well as futurology, rather seriously, I know what I am talking, what way I am saying so. A competitive politics and populistic policies dictate our course today, where the concern and preoccupation is short-sighted. Scope for futurology is very limited, and that's where the task today is challenging. And this 10th anniversary lecture, I'm sure, is going to be a turning point of this psyche gripping the country today. But today, we should be concerned about transforming. In fact, the book title of it is Transforming India. It's Transforming India is transforming the people of the country. Even more so, unless we transform the lifestyles of people, there can't be a transformation. And that's where the Dr. Seth's, one of the differences between the other futurologist, is their mainly concern is the technologies, technology forecasting and technology outlook. But SATISH has brought in the social, as I think you mentioned that very correctly. That is the unique point that we need to remember from that perspective. So I have 6 specific points that I would like to mention for the consideration of this group and to take forward. The book deserves a much more serious discussion, not just kind of a concluding way of this today's important program. So maybe there could be some other occasion or some other forum where we could take it forward to discuss this under this organization's leadership. The second is the book shall do the magic of reviving. How do we revive it? Now, Dr. SETH himself has taken several initiatives. In fact, very interesting way he has put it. He took so much pains in coming up with such a detailed manner, which committees and meetings after meeting, if you see the education policy, the number of pages they devoted, the time that they took, and what Dr. SETH has written about the syllabus for futurology for different levels is amazing. I think that should be the thread that we need to take up today and approach the education policy, the new education policy, which is not yet officialized. It is still the discussion stage, and I think I'm sure Dr. Padma SETH has already written to them suggesting that they should include this as a part of their recommendation. If I don't know whether it has been done or not, but it should be taking from today's Bharat Ratna's speech and his program, this 10th anniversary should be an occasion to take it forward with that report, that they should include a part of this. And similarly, the third point is the ICSR, Indian Council of Social Science Research, the UGC, and the TIFAC. I don't know whether TIFAC is another organization which Abdul floated, but unfortunately, I don't know what is the status. Do you know anything about it? I was involved in it in the initial years. I was one of the members of it looking into the social sector forecasting of that. But afterwards, I never heard anything about it or their work. In fact, I don't even know whether it exists or not.
It does.
Yeah, you are the right person, you know. So, but I don't know their work. You should. But the point I'm making is that these three organizations, particularly the ICSR has a lot of grants, friends, and their mission is this. And I have not heard them doing anything. Recently, I visited them after 20 years, after J.P. Naik. J.P. Naik was the founder secretary of that organization in the early 70s. I visited them recently because I wanted to update myself in some other connection of my book, which was forthcoming book. So I was really shattered. A huge infrastructure they have, but they haven't done anything worthwhile to take forward. So I think they need to be written, Dr. Aditya. You should write to them, ICSR, UGC, and TIFAC. Unless we keep doing things, we can't keep up this futurology point of it. Then another interesting thing about Dr. SETH is the artificial intelligence. SETH has realized that the preface, in the preface it was referred to that the data and analytics, unless we are seriously pursue, take up this futurology, this artificial intelligence is going to be a disaster, in my opinion.
He used the expression anticipatory management.
Yeah. I think that's what he has said, as that need to be revived, because artificial intelligence, we are going in a big way. There is a big mela is going on in the country, but nobody is talking about this. Dr. SETH has referred to this in his own way, so early, 30 years, 20 years ago. So that is another point that I want to mention as a part of this. And lastly, the Prime Minister Modi is very good in initiating mindset addressed issues. And I think he should also take up and give a national call that we should be futuristic oriented, much beyond 5-year perspective or beyond an election concern thing. This is a good theme that he could expect. I think Aditya and Dr. Padma Seth should write to him with a copy and a summing up things and as a concluding recommendation of this 10th year anniversary thing to the Prime Minister as well. Thank you very much.
So me?
You, please.
Sure. I'm going to be brief. When Dr. Padma Seth asked me that, okay, you and Mr. Rao,
Bhaskar Rao,
know him and had known him personally, so it will be nice that you could speak on this and about the book. Now, it's very interesting. I, in fact, came in touch with her only through Dr. Seth. And when I got the first job in the Department of Science and Technology, we were sitting in Vigyan Bhavan. And Dr. Seth used to be next to my room. And we had a secretary called, this is the lighter side, because I want you to, you know, imagine how futurology developed at that time. It was 1973, ancient. So, and we had a secretary, Jamal Kidwai, who was, of course, from, he was on the media side, and he came in, and this was his first secretary. The ministry had just been created. We were very few people, the nucleus, who came in to deal with this ministry. And our secretary was such a busy person, he used to come to office only after lunch. So it was like our work started after lunch, he'll come after 5 o'clock, everybody has to be ready. So by the time you finish, maybe 7, 7:30, what will you do otherwise? There are a lot of things for thinking, doing. And so we used to spend a lot of time together. And I never knew about, at that time, we had a thing charted out, new ministry, new things, new departments, and how to, we never had an office. So this new US aid building, near Kutub Hotel, which now is called Department of Science and Technology's office, we had to go and survey one day and find out, and that's how we got into that building. Prior to that, in Vigyan Bhavan was the time when I spent most of the time with him. Very interesting. It is my privilege, actually, I feel, that I'm being a part of this whole discussion, because it was a very close association with Dr. Seth. And he was flying all the time imagining things. And I used to be sometimes wondering, what is this gentleman doing? He's not talking about something what needs to be done today, talks about several years ahead. And the whole idea was, oh, it's going to be like this 30 years hence, it's going to be like this 40 years hence. But it was an enjoyed, you can say, conversation which used to have. A lot of new things developed at that time. And I was not even imagining at some point of time I get to see this restless. He was a restless person. This is a correct definition for this gentleman. And what you see today, in fact, if you go through the foreword of Dr. Mashelkar in this book, he has very aptly summarized the whole book, beautifully written. And that's truly, it's absolutely correct. That is, say, how the whole transition had happened. You know, there are 3-4 major transitions which happened. What he thought at that time, and 21st century, we are today here. And exactly we see that happening. And that is why I feel he was so true to himself that he imagined a lot of things. And at that time, we were not even knowing how to put it down in a piece of paper and probably publish. And it would have been like, you have this financial crisis in US, somebody comes out with a great idea in the bank saying, oh, this is going to be the crisis in the next 10 years, and everybody jumps and says, oh, this is what this gentleman has brought out, but Dr. Seth did that. Now, the first and foremost was oil. I mean, he was always saying that it's going to be a civilization different than oil, it will be non-oil civilization, society, and truly we are moving more and more towards non-fossil fuel, renewable energy sources, I mean, the kind of developments which are happening worldwide, it is so. Similarly, information technology, how it's so important, connected with data. I mean, it's so true that today, digital technology, information technology today, I mean, whole thing, he did that in 1973, 74, when we were talking in a room, you know. And as he was mentioning now, data analytics, and he was way ahead of his time. It's unimaginable of things which he thought. And I still recall, and we used to share this information, because later on, I went into ONGC, we were still in touch with him at that time. And we used to get in ONGC, you know, reports about, in 1985 I'm talking, 82, 85, around that time, that Japan brought out a report about, because they were short of energy. Japan has hardly any energy resources of their own. But they were producing so much energy, using from outside, using it so aptly, how to manage that. They produced a report and planning of 2050 in the year 1980, 82, 83 at that time. So you see the kind of span of futuristic thinking, planning, how you can go ahead. I mean, I used to think about and tell him also, look, this is what, so he used to tell me, look, I said that when we were sitting together, that this is what is going to happen. Second important trend is also about skilled human resources. He was telling, oh, this country needs so much. We need to train them, we need to skill them. Now you imagine what he said that today. That I remember when we were all students, we were all used to go to science. Everybody will go to science, the brightest kids will go to science. And you will become engineers, you will become scientists, you will become doctors. And you had a stage where, I remember in Miranda House, the principal was telling, there is nobody who is applying for chemistry. And I happened to be a chemistry, two PhDs, so she called me one day when I became a CEO of a public sector company to promote more students taking chemistry. That, look, you can do a great job, take chemistry. But why is it so? Because our whole planning process in education, that we are not really looking at future, what is it that is going to happen? So you have a huge amount of you know, scientists, engineers, numbers created, but not having enough jobs, looking for jobs. So this mismatch between the training process, the skilling process, he imagined at that time. And he was, in fact, it's Mashelkar has mentioned it about, yes, HR skilling. Today we are talking about HR skilling, there is a skilling ministry and all that. So it's a great you know, thinking, which of course fortunately got translated into this book. I would in fact feel that it really calls for every day we on TV show, we have all kinds of discussion today, more relating to politics and so many people killed, so many, this is what happened, every day police with uniform sitting there. But I think we should be having discussion of this type and get people to talk, and the TV channels must, you know, encourage debates of this type, which is more positive and positive for the country as a whole, for future. And he is, another interesting thing he did was a crisis analysis methodology. I mean, how do you analyze a crisis? I mean, how do you define the crisis is going to happen? Today we are facing a crisis, truly, in terms of jobs, in terms of economy, whatever, some sort of crisis. Now, How do you analyze, and he in fact defined a methodology which was adopted by the, I think, National Council for Science and Technology, NCST, which was a scientific method of collecting data and information, and then you evolve that kind. And it's not his own, but worldwide, I think he discussed with a lot of people who are knowledgeable in the world in this subject, and then evolved this methodology, which was adopted. I don't know where it has disappeared. We don't know. Yeah, but it was actually in the government at that time. This crisis methodology was adopted officially and was put into practice. The last, I would only like to just highlight one interesting experience of mine when I was in cement industry, and relating it to what he has mentioned in his book as well, connected with the rural and urban divide that we talk about. Like, we've created huge divides in every aspect of divide you can think of, whether it is caste, whether it is religion, And also gender, my God, I mean, gender is a huge divide which is going on now. So we said, okay, he said aspirations of human beings, people, are the same. Whether you are in rural area or you are in semi-urban or you are in urban area, it all depends on the span and the magnitude of what kind. But everybody has got aspiration. When I was briefly in cement, we were developing in a research project. This institute was Cement Research Institute under the Ministry of Industry. Of a project, you have waste material like your fly ash from thermal power project, or your steel plant slag cement, fly ash cement. So it's going waste. So we will develop some bricks. So it's develop new building material. So the question was, okay, where will you market it? So I said, oh, no, rural areas. This institute was in Ballabgarh in Haryana. So he said, okay, around that area we will look for and we will market this product. Now, interesting was, I said, I was actually looking after the development scheme of that institute at that time. So he said, okay, we will go and market. So I went, we sent the team and I went myself to talk to some of those people. Yeah, these bricks, we made the bricks. I said, okay, sell. So people were not buffoons, you know, sitting there. So he's saying, kya cheez hai? So when we mentioned what exactly it is, so he said, saab, makan, jindagi mein ek dafe banta hai. Portland cement se banayenge, kuch nahi. So we were not able to market. So it's a simple example, absolute grassroots example, to say that people would like to have the best of everything within their own ability. They all have aspirations. They all want to send the children to the best of schools. So we cannot take chances in saying there is something for rural, something for urban. Education has to be universal, same for everybody. Similarly, for everything which is applicable to the urban areas must get applicable in terms of services, whether it is health, whether it's education, or anything else on food, everything should be same. So that I salute Dr. Seth for the kind of imagination that he had at that time, and which finally, thank Mr. Kapoor, converted this into a book of this type, which at least should be useful for future generation, and I think it will be probably useful in schools and colleges, and I think it should be greatly promoted. Talk to the University Grants Commission, it should be in the library of all the universities, all the technical institutions in the schools and colleges, should have discussions on the national media, should get published relentlessly in every possible manner in media. Even if you have to follow all kinds of methods, you have to all follow all kinds of methods to get it done. Because it's extremely important. If Japan can do that, a planning for 50 years, 70 years ahead, why not? And you see, we have a lot of opportunity which can be worked out. US, for example, I'll conclude with this statement. A country like US in one decade, which was actually a net importer of fossil fuels, oil, became net exporter of oil. Now, it was simple that only people have put together the resources which were available with them. It was just nothing more than just the future thinking. And this thinking has been happening in US for a long time, but it was actually reinforced and put into practice during Obama's time. Because energy was like everybody was exploiting those people who were actually selling oil to them. So you see, they are on the seller's market today, and they're selling to India the shale oil. So I conclude by saying, by saluting and thanking Aditya and Padma Seth for giving me this opportunity to share with you some of my very close experiences with Dr. Seth, and we miss him badly. Thank you. Thank you.
Dr. Bhaskar, author Rakesh Kapoorji, and Irina Ramachandranji. It's indeed a great pleasure to read this wonderful book, to know the wonderful personality. The earlier speakers have two advantages. First, they spoke earlier. Second is they know, they met, they spoke, they worked with Dr. Satish. So I have no, that, I don't have that advantage. But still, the book took me to the past, and so that I understand the future of the country and future ideology of Dr. Seth. That is a great advantage for me now. Now, I would like to say one word was really very, very effective in the entire book, and that is taken from his writings and concept. That is grip of the past. I was really enamored by this word, grip of the past. We are all in the grip of the past. And he quotes one interesting example, statistics, that all our textbooks do have 99% or 97% of past and nothing about future. That is really interesting. Even Pranab Mukherjee was talking about that. So most of it is past. Now, I related it to my education and I related it to my teachings today. When I was a student of BSc, I was reading textbook of English. There is only one lesson I remember today. That is about streamlining. It is a science lesson. It so beautifully writes about the mechanical streamlining that appears through the air resistance and increases the speed. It's a scientific lesson in English literature, English textbook. It is, even today, when I see a streamlined car or product, I remember that lesson. That shows how futuristic lesson is very important in a curriculum. Now, I teach constitutional law. I relate to the grip of the past that has on me and several others. I mostly depend on the constitutional history. I'm not saying that history is relevant and past is totally to be written off. It is very, very relevant to understand the experience of the earlier constitutionally governed states and understand why they brought that principle inside. B.N. Rao is the person who brought all the best practices available in different constitutions into India. But it is Ambedkar who gave it futuristic term. So that is the greatness of Ambedkar. Now, when I am teaching this, I am teaching what Ambedkar said, what B.N. Rao said, what that fellow said, what fellow this fellow said, what happened in 1950, why it was so in 1947. But am I teaching what is happening constitutionally now? Am I teaching? That was the question I put to myself. And okay, I might be teaching. Generally, I definitely related to the current affairs. I was discussing the union and its territories in my classroom. There I discussed Article 370, Jammu and Kashmir, reorganization of states, everything, which is so dynamically happening now. How can we ignore it? But most of the teachers in my board of studies meetings and university syllabus committees, what I hear is, no, that is not there in the syllabus. Why are you talking about it? So it should be there in the syllabus. And what is that should be there in the syllabus? Why are you not incorporating the present? And if you cannot incorporate the present, how do you talk about future? And what will happen to constitutional governance tomorrow is a question. And now I found one sentence relating to governance, one very excellent point relating to governance in his book. That is, we have to rebuild the bureaucracy. He said it long, long ago. He has to rebuild the bureaucracy. It's a very, very interesting phenomena. And today, it is not just political leadership that we have to blame for everything. We have to understand the importance and relevance and the way the bureaucracy is functioning. It is good and it has good and bad, but bad is increasing. Then how do we tackle it? Now, I just remember one talk of my colleague. He says, in coaching the IAS and the civil service examination centers are in coaching for judicial service. Do you know what they teach? They teach what article deals with what. Deals with what, that's all. What does that article say? Nobody bothers. What is the principle behind it? Nobody bothers. So you are not ready to understand what is there inside, and they pass civil service and they become administrators. One wonderful conflict was reported in WhatsApp communication. He says he will write a beautiful article against dowry. Wonderful 1,000 words article. And then he passes the civil services, joins the service, and he'll increase his rate of dowry. So you don't understand that you think that you should be coached to become a collector or IAS officer, but you don't understand that to administer a nation for the future. So to that extent, I think we should have a wonderful idea about the future. What are we going to do in the future? That way, he's the leader, the thought leader. And another point in this context I want to say is, he talked about data collection, data analysis, and data communication. Long, long ago, And what are we doing today? We are talking about big data, big information, and the information technology, information communication technology, we are talking about it. We are processing, you are using ICT to process the information available. There is a super highway of information, and we don't know what information we have to select. That is the world we are living in. And in this context, what he's talked about, rebuilding of bureaucracy and information processing, is being realized. And that's again my field, that is right to information. Right to information in combination with information technology is going to address the present system, and it is going to cure the present ills of present system, and it is going to offer a better future, better governance. And that's what he was talking about, information analysis. We don't have anything. I remembered yesterday's event. I was yesterday in Rajasthan. They launched a portal called Jan Suchna Portal. Do you know what it contains? It contains about the services offered by the government. 20 services offered by 13 departments at a click of the mouse. Very well using, well exploited resource of information technology to tell the people that this is available. These are the processes, these are the schemes of the government, and you have to use it. And this is where you can use it. You will have it. And not only that, he gives updated information. It gives updated information. What is that updated information? I applied for ration yesterday, ration card yesterday. I got it today. That will be there available. And I took ration today. Gehu liya maine aaj. Then what is that you can avail tomorrow? Stock is available. That information is there. You can go and get it by so-and-so date is also available. What is not available is also there. This is the using data, information, analyzing it for the better governance, better utilization of the money, better administration, good governance, and good future. So that way, I think this book has really reflected the very relevant thought process of Satish Seth about the future. And if you don't read this, I think your eyes will not open. He also makes a very interesting reference to our Indian culture. Why are we not looking into future? That he analyzed it. And he says it is karma theory. Karma theory. We all think that we are like this because of our purva janma, purva karma. We are like this. So we are just reconciled to it. We want yesterday to be today. We want yesterday to be tomorrow also. We convert today into yesterday. We convert tomorrow into yesterday. That is his word. I'll read his word for that because it's a very interesting statement. Even though tomorrows do not repeat yesterdays, yet most people and most societies try not only to perpetuate yesterdays, but unconsciously even carry them forward into tomorrows. All thinking men and women should instead be asked if they are turning their tomorrows into yesterdays. If so, why? It's a very, very interesting question. And his most important question, two-word question is, what next? This is the most asking question and everybody should ask. I would like to read one more paragraph and conclude. Though he is no more and lived in yesteryears, Satish C.SETH is not yesterday. He has not passed away. He is here as present, as representative of future. He is now in today's world as his thoughts are as fresh as the context and latest. He is also the tomorrow as the vision he envisioned will be coming to reality. Because he expected that. It is very apt that the former president Bharat Pranab Mukherjee delivered Satish C.SETH memorial lecture and paid rich tributes. At the end, I'd like to conclude thanking Padma Seth Ji, Aditya Ji for giving me this opportunity. And I'm very happy that I read this book. I'm reading this book. I'm happy to meet Rakesh Kapoor, who really presented the personality in a very, very crisp manner. If you read these 200 pages, you'll understand him. And perhaps you will look into the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rao, Dr. Ramachandran, and Dr. Acharyalu. I really don't have much to say because I think all your reflections are very interesting, both from the personal point of view and also in terms of your very kind words about how this can actually help in the attempt to revive future studies. I fully agree that that's the purpose. I'll just say very few points. I tried as much as possible in this book to let Dr. Seth speak through his own words. I mean, he had so many gems of, as you know. Dr. Acharyalu was quoting some of the concepts and ideas. There were so many interesting ideas and concepts and gems in his writing. And I have tried to just go back to the basics and try to present, why study the future, for instance. What is important about the future? Very basic concepts, trying to put it as simply as possible in his own words, not trying to, you know, because there is also one style of writing which tries to mystify things. Well, I always attempt to sort of simplify and sort of, you know, say things in a way that people will be able to understand simply. So, and then, I mean, it's very true that, you know, he was remarkable, and that's why I said, to that extent, his work is not known. You know, to that extent is not known. So I was sharing this information about the book with my international group, World Future Studies Federation, and Professor Jim Dater, who's like 85 years old, and he was has also been referred to as one of the people who inspired Dr. Seth. He's still alive. He's editor of the World Future Review. And he sent a message on our listserv saying that, you know, I really admire the work that Satish Seth did for introducing futures literacy and pushing futures literacy in India. And I hope that this book will be able to, and it was not recognized much, and I hope that this book will be able to sort of address that imbalance. So that's the point. I mean, that he brought out very beautifully the need for futures literacy. So that's why there is one chapter in the book which is called Education for the Future and the Future of Education. So and then the courses that he, you know, designed at the master's level, at the MPhil level, and even at the school level. Now, unfortunately, you see, the forces of resistance in India are also very strong. I mean, even if somebody tries to do some great thing, it's not very easily sort of accepted. I'll give you one example. Dr. Seth tried in the 90s to set up the Commission for the Future for Delhi. I mean, it's so... All of us being sort of Delhiites, we can realize how important a thing that would be. And he wrote to two lieutenant governors, and part of that correspondence is included in the annexures here. And you can see the detail in which he wrote and said that this is what we need to do. I mean, I think all of us will understand and appreciate the importance of that idea. A commission for the future for Delhi. A lot of cities in the world have it. You know, some of the, you know, the places where futures thinking is done more, like USA and Europe and Australia and so on. I mean, but, I mean, what can you do? Because if the people in the bureaucracy and the decision makers are not very receptive, I mean, there are good standardized responses that, okay, I've asked this to be examined, it shall be, you know, we will look into it and so on, but then nothing happens.
Computer gives those answers. Computer gives answers.
Yeah. So nothing happens. So similarly, you know, that's why the three or four substantive chapters in the book are on the very substantive contributions he made, you know, on the whole question of rebuilding bureaucracy and reforming governance. On the corporate side, he had this whole thing about anticipatory management. And he had these two lovely small booklets. They are, you know, like 4-inch by 4-inch size booklets, which are on my 3 days as Prime Minister, and where he adopts the methodology of saying that I woke up from a dream, and in the dream I thought I was Prime Minister, and he mentions a lot of things. And there's another one on business. So, yeah?
Corporate futures.
So where, you know, he has like very pragmatic, down-to-earth talking to businessmen. He says, Dr. Seth's tips for making a million. So, you know, very futuristic. So that's, I mean, definitely he was brilliant, and I hope that through this book, by sort of again introducing his ideas as I've expressed in the book also, that it's hopefully, you know, and by the efforts of ICMF and so on, I hope that there is a revitalization of this quest. It's about time that we need to sort of take this whole question of the futures very much more seriously again. I mean, I think that if today Dr. Seth was there, I mean, one thing he would have definitely applied his mind to a lot would be the whole very big question of climate change. Very, very big question of climate change, because that's one of the biggest challenges humanity is facing now in the next few decades. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Just stand.
Stand.
Yeah, stand. You know the.
So let's take this, sir, for the photograph.
Thank you so much. Thank you.